So, yeah, in this talk, I want to present you basically mostly the workflow on how to do that in Abinet. So I think 2 years ago, I showed you some of the development steps. And to start out, I want just to give a short reminder on the theoretical background, but it's important for that. And then I will show you the workflow and some example results. And so the most important part is, of course, spin orbit coupling. As probably many of you know, spin orbit coupling is a relativistic effect that you can get as an approximation from the Dirac equation. And one of the most important effects of spin orbit coupling is the spin orbit splitting. Can you see the laser pointer?
Yes, it's okay.
Wonderful. So the most important effect is the spin orbit splitting. So for example, if you have a 2p level with spin orbit coupling, it will split up into a 2p 3/2 and a 2p 1/2 level. And that is something that you can see in X-ray spectra. So it's very important to have this included in your calculation if you want to simulate X-ray spectras. And in Abinet itself, spin orbit coupling is implemented via this spin orbit coupling term. So it mainly couples the orbital momentum to the spin operator. And since the spin operator couples spin up and spin down states, we have then a mixture of those, and we have in the results two spinor wave functions. So if you activate it with nspinor2, this term also will be automatically activated, and you will get spinor calculations. The thing is, of course, Abinet uses a frozen core approximation, and therefore we also need some way to get this spin orbit coupling to the core wave functions, which we do not automatically get with Abinet. But luckily, Natalie has included such capabilities inside of Atom Power. And it's actually a little bit more than that, just spin orbit coupling. It's actually the full radial symmetric Dirac equation that is now implemented in Atom Power. So it actually can even calculate four spinors. And there's basically an analytical form which can consists of radial equations F and G and F, which have to be solved numerically by Atom Power. And there are also the so-called relativistic spherical harmonics. And those are actually implemented in Abinet when you want to evaluate the matrix element for the transition from a core level to a valence band state when you're doing X-ray spectroscopy calculations. So that is the background. Now, how do you go about actually doing this calculation within Abinet? So first of all, you need to generate this core wave function. Sadly, there's not yet a large table where those would be available. But what you can do is you can go to the normal PAW GATH table, for example, and at the end of each of those XML files that you can download from the Abinet website, there's actually the input file added, which was used to generate this input file. And with a few steps, you can use this input file to generate actually your Dirac relativistic core wave functions. So first step is you need to replace the keyword semi-relativistic that is usually used for the JTH table with Dirac relativistic. Then you need to define some additional states because, of course, due to the spin orbit splitting, several degeneracies that were present without spin orbit coupling have now been lifted. So, for example, instead of a 2p state, you will have a 2p 1/2 and 2p 3/2 state, as I said before. And to distinguish those two states, there's actually a new variable called kappa, which is equal to -L +1 for the spin parallel phase, so for 3/2. and equal to L for the spin anti-parallel case. So P1 half, for example. And then you can use the keywords XML out and PAT core wave function to actually print out a XML core wave function that can be used then in a VNet. So just as an example, if you take aluminium, you exchange this keyword, you might need to change the grid. It's in general a good idea before you do something with it to check that the PLW tutorial where there's a short introduction on how to use atom part to be able to understand that. And then the main difference is that here in the definition of the levels, you now have to differentiate it between the spin up and spin spin parallel and anti-parallel levels, basically. So where you just would have to say, okay, for aluminium, this 3P level has one electron inside it. You now have to differentiate, okay, the 3P one half has one electrons, the 3P two half has zero electrons. So this has, and of course you now have more levels available due to this splitting. So you also have to change that. And finally, you also have to modify this output. And if everything is well, you have that works immediately. Of course, there can be numerical problems. So you might have to adjust things like the grid or some of those separation values here. But that's basically similar to the process that you would use to get it for the non-Dirac relativistic case. So the second step is then, of course, to run up init. So you need this core wave function file, which ends on .corewave.xml, and your normal PLW potential as usual. And I think it should have the same names for it to work, and should be in the same directory as a PLW potential. And then, of course, you need to activate the spinors, and spinor equals 2. And I think at the moment it's still set to PRT nublas 3 and this long number here. I definitely need to change it to PRT nublas 5 to activate the actual spin orbit calculation. And if you have NetCDF support enabled, which by now should be standard if I remember correctly, then you definitely should also use IO mode 3 because that allows for much more stable output file because those can get quite large and the Fortran ones tend to make problems in that case. And one of the most important convergence parameter beside all the others that you usually want to check is in this case N-bun because you want to have the excited states calculated. And that is one of the very important convergence parameters that must be much larger than you would do for an ordinary ground state calculation. And so you have to check whether your spectrum is actually converged with the number of bands that you use as at least up to the range of energy that you are interested in. And then finally you get this, an output file. This is a binary file. If you used IO mode 3, hopefully then you have a .nc file and that contains the matrix element data. Actually, if you use NetCDF, you can also try to use this with other programs. It doesn't have to be up in its own software. Speaking of which, the last step is to run Conducti that works in the same way as it used to without spin orbit coupling. So you would choose mode 5, you would use the input root name of the file independent of whether you have NetCDF or not. It will just detect it and use NetCDF if it's available. And the input parameters for the spectrum, so the resolution and the smearing and so on, which is mentioned in the program. And if you do all that, you can get results, hopefully. Otherwise, you can write me an email. One of the one of our favorite results is the XENIS, so the X-ray in the edge spectroscopy from the Kappa L2 L3 edge. So L2 edge is basically the one that comes from 2pH 1/2 to the valence band, and the L3 edge is from 3p 3/2 to the 2p 3/2 to the valence band. And since you since we have now the spin orbit splitting directly calculated, we can have a very good match with experiments. So there's maybe half an eV off in the splitting. The whole thing had to be shifted, of course, because DFT is not perfect. but we also get very good the branching ratio between the two edges, so that also matches very well with experiments. So we just have to basically fit this one point here for the blue curve, and if we then add the magenta curve with the same fitting and scaling, then we really are very close to experiment. And maybe an even better example is if you go to gold, because in gold you do not only have the splitting in the core that is very important, but also you have the effects on the D bands due to spin orbit coupling. And then actually you get, if you superimpose those two edges, it's basically the same as in Kappa. If you superimpose those two edges, you may actually see that the shape at the edge is different depending on which edge you look at. Even if you scale them to the same size. And so you have what is, I think, experimentally called a white line feature, where you have really a different shape, and that is actually also seen in experiment, and at least here in the beginning it's very well represented. Later on we don't match the experiment as well, but this main feature can be represented, and that's really only due to having spinors with spin orbit coupling, where you basically can see that from the there's no transition from the one the p1/2 to the d5/2 like bands in the valence band. And that is the main reason for this difference. Yes, and with that, I want to acknowledge all the people that helped me to work on this. That's first Vanina, Mark, and Natalie, of course. And we recently published those results in this publication here. And while I'm now at XFEL, all this work was actually done at CER and of course with Sabine, as you all know. And with that, I would thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you for this interesting talk. So I guess people start to be tired because no questions in the chat yet. And okay, and the fully relativistic correction is mostly for the core states, what you are doing.
Yeah, so I mean, the thing is already the PAW potentials that are in a GTX table, they are already scalar relativistic.
Yes.
Scalar relativistic does not include spin orbit coupling. So we need the spin orbit coupling, but we don't want to lose the scalar relativistic properties, which are important for the higher elements, definitely. And so that's probably the reason why it was decided to go completely direct relativistic for that.
I guess for alpha electron systems would be quite important then.
Yeah, as well, yeah.
I see, so yeah. Okay, and we have questions coming from Fabien. How large is the energy shift you need to apply? How does it change with the function?
I don't know how it changes with the functional, but I think it was around 20 eV in this case. So, I mean, we were around 930 eV. I'm not sure how much it changes with the functional, but the interesting part is actually if you don't do spin orbit coupling, you actually with the one level that you get then, because you don't have two, you're actually closer to the L2 edge, but that's pretty much meaningless because you basically have a mixture between L2 and L3 if you do that. But I'm not sure how it depends on the functional.
Okay, and there is a question from Xavier. Does it work for D or F core state?
Yeah, of course. It also does. I mean, you have to, of course, know how those states are defined, because of course you don't have 2-4 but in splitting, but like 4-6 I think, and the other one was not sure, 8-6 or something like that. But in theory you can just go up to F, or maybe even higher, but it doesn't really matter to get this. Yeah.
Okay. And we have just small practical detail. That's the how heavy is this core wave function file, core WF file?
The core wave function file is not heavy. That is basically similar to a PAW potential.
Okay. And why not merging it into the potential file then? So we have only one file.
Well, I mean, I think the problem is that there are different. That's a good question. I mean, sometimes
because we could have a GTH table for Dirac relativistic, and then we don't know the one file, and that's it.
Yeah, but I mean, sometimes the conversions can be a little bit different, so. Not sure whether this is a good idea to do it really with the same file. But one could think about this, yeah.
Let me discuss, yeah.